自然と体が動き出す歯切れのいいリズム、マイシャローだ。マイシャローナのリフを生み出したザ・ナックのギタリスト、バートン・アベール。
Well, the riff dictated that, because the riff is really staccato. The notes don't sustain. It's right? And so when the bass is playing it along with the guitars, it just has this real united, again, I'd like to think, if I had to describe it, it's aggression. You know, it's not a pretty thing, it's an in-your-face thing.
Impressive riff を支えたベーシスト、プレスコット・ナイルズ。
Starts off with the drums and then the bass, and immediately you want to dance. You're hooked. And it's funny because the lyric, My Sharona, a lot of people back then and even to this day ask me what the song's about. I swear they don't understand. Sharona is in Israel, that name is equivalent to Sharon. Through the years, people have, I swear, what's a song? What's a Sharona? And I go, don't you get it? So I think the lyric added some mystery to what the song's about.
Toji, その style からも、ビートルズの再来とプロモーションされたザ・ナック、大ヒット曲の誕生を探る。1979年の大ヒット曲「マイ・シャローナ」。この曲でザ・ナックの名は世界中に知れ渡った。曲を生み出したメンバーをロサンゼルスに訪ねた。迎えてくれたのはザ・ナックのリードギターバートン・アーベール。
In the early 70s, Doug and I met in a band. It was like a play for pay situation. There was a singer and he needed a band, and so we'd get, you know, starvation wages, but it was a gig. And Doug said the first day, he goes, I really like the way you play. I'm looking for somebody to write with. And I said, sure, you know. And so we started writing together. And we became a unit, and this is like we, you know, at that point we just clicked a songwriting partnership. And Doug was always like the leader with the ideas, and this is what we're going to do, and this is, and so we were trying to get some kind of foothold, you know, with demo tapes and things like that. And in 1978, Doug said, you know, the club scene was happening in Los Angeles. There was the Troubadour, there was the Whiskey, there was the Starwood. And there was a lot of buzz and excitement about bands, unsigned bands, local bands. And so Doug said, let's just be live. That's the way we're going to sell our music, is just be a live band. And that was how The Knack started.
バートン・アベールがリードギター、ダグ・ファイガーがボーカルとリズムギターを担当、ダグの知り合いだったドラムのブルース・ゲイリー、そしてブルースの知り合いのベーシストプレスコット・ナイルズが集まり、1978年にバンドザ・ナックは結成された。ザ・フーのジョン・エント・ウィッスルに影響を受けたというベーシストプレスコット・ナイルズ。ザ・ナックは最初からワクワクするようなバンドだったと語った。
I think we were just pretty much playing rock and roll. I mean, if you listen to it, there's no key, you know, synthesizers, no keyboards. I mean, the core of the band was just really a three-piece with a rhythm guitarand vocal two-part harmonies mainly. So it was pretty standard for rock and roll. A lot of the bands we loved, like The Who and The Beatles, etc., Stones, they had five though, but still it was guitar-based. So I think The Knack was a combination of everything we all grew up with and just adding our own individual styles to the rock and roll sound. We weren't trying to make anything new. Whatever that was, but by playing what we played, it was new, because a lot of the bands were playing more formula rock and roll. They didn't know what they want. A lot of people were playing more disco or different things. So we were just playing rock and roll.
当時、イギリスではパンクやニューウェーブ、アメリカではディスコミュージックやインダストリアルロックが主流だった。そんな中、シンプルでベーシックなロックスタイルのザ・ナックは逆にその新鮮さが際立った。
We happened to be a band that could play really well, and yet at the same time the way we presented the band was very stripped down, very fundamental, and so we appealed to people who were really going for the new wave thing, and at the same timeWe put on a really good show because we could dazzle them. So right from the start, it was an exciting thing in the clubs. From our first gig, people would like, we would come to play the second gig at the Troubadour, and there were twice as many people as the first because word of mouth, was, you know.
ロサンゼルスの音楽シーンで一躍注目を集めた。ザ・ナック、多くのレコード会社が彼らとの契約を競い合った。いくつものオファーの中からザ・ナックはキャピトルレコードと契約、プロデューサー選びが始まった。
Were the hot item, and a lot of name producers were interested in producing us. Big name producers coming and seeing us, and they would literally sometimes pass each other, like, you know, so-and-so was coming out and so-and-so was coming in, and oh yeah, hi, how you doing? And there had been an interview in the LA Times, and Doug had said he had mentioned off the top of his head some producers we'd like to work with. And Mike told us that he saw the article and he was pissed off that he wasn't on the list. So it was like an ego thing. So he said, look, I want to come and see these guys.
プロデューサー、マイク・チャップマン。マイクは1970年代のイギリスで、ソングライターチーム、チン&チャップマンとして活動。プロデュースも務め、数々のバンドやヒット曲を世に送り出した。
this.
イギリスで成功を収めたチン&チャップマン。マイク・チャップマンはアメリカの音楽シーンにも可能性を求め、1975年にアメリカに渡った。アメリカで最初のヒットとなったのがカントリー系バンドエグザイルのこの曲だった。マイクがアメリカで活動を始めた頃からのアシスタントデイビッド・ティックルに話を聞いた。
First of all, he's got a great background in writing. He's really good at writing songs.And he can recognize a hit. He knows how to take something that's got the potential of being a hit and working with the artist and rearranging and putting certain chords in or adding a bridge maybe. So he's a very musical producer. He's a pop producer and as opposed to at that time there was a lot of disco, there was a lot of progressive rock music, and rock, big rock music was kind of starting to come out at that time as well. But he just had this sensibility of radio, pop hits, and, but they were substantial.
He comes in and we, you know, play live. And like I said, we were a tight band. We could just present it. And he said, my idea of recording you guys is to just turn the machine on and have you play like you're playing at the Troubadour. And that's exactly what we thought we should do. And so that's what won us over, is we said, yeah, he's got the right idea.
ヒットメーカー、マイク・チャップマンをプロデューサーに迎え、ザ・ナックはデビューアルバムの制作に入る。ロサンゼルス郊外に立つ一軒の家、ここにマイ・シャローナと大きな関わりを持つ人物を訪ねた。
Hi.
Hi.
How are you?
Nice to meet you.
Oh, I'm so happy to meet you too, Lizzie.
彼女こそマイ・シャローナのモデル、シャローナ。
They are going to say, if they don't say, oh, like my Sharona, or they don't go, then I know in their head, just like they're just going like, I say, hi, my name's Sharona, and they're like, my Sharona. I just know that it's in their head. It's almost a natural response. Oh, I'm so sorry. You probably hear that all the time, people tell me. And sometimes I go, you know, that's really my song. And sometimes I'll not.Say anything. Many times people don't even believe me and I don't have the energy. And then, you know, when I tell people, they're like, no, no way. You know, can I take a picture? I'm calling my husband right now. And they get so excited that for me to ever have an attitude or anything about it or get sick, it would be ridiculous because people really have like good moments of it and good memories of it. And, you know, I wouldn't want to ruin that. And you know, I'm grateful. It was, you know, it's cool.
シャローナはザ・ナックとどんな関係があったのだろうか。曲の誕生をメンバーに聞いた。有名なこのリフはバートンがバンド結成前から作っていたと言われているが、実はそうではなく、結成直後だと彼は言った。
I was listening a lot at that time to the second Elvis Costello album, This Year's Model.
there were certain passages that were so primal, and it was like nothing. That's what people were attracted to from this music, because it sounded like this kind of berserk, what we now call garage music from the 60s, you know, like talk. It's like, it's just slam your head against the wall and no subtlety whatsoever, and it's just this. And specifically the drum breakdown and Pump It Up, and the song Pump It Up, is it just felt like this aggressive, push your table over kind of feel. And so I started to play a riff, because, you know, you always want to come up with a riff for a song. And I guess I was just going as simple as possible. So it's an octave riff, just basically the two notes in an octave, and the turnaround chords. And I remember just slamming it out on the guitar and hitting it out on the piano, and I go, this is a good riff, this is really cool. And I brought it into a rehearsal. And without saying anything to Doug, like, I think I got something, you know, I just started playing the riff. And the only instruction or anything I gave was, I mentioned to the drummer that it's not a conventional hi-hat, you know, like, backbeat kind of thing, that it's more like toms and snare, because that's what the drum breakdown in Pump It Up was, like that. And Bruce just, you know, took the ball and ran with it. Obviously, I didn't have to tell him much. And Prescott just copped the riff and played. And so we were just basically jamming that, and Doug was scat singing over it, you know, just flying off the top of his head. And we stopped after a certain amount, and Doug says, that's great, let's go home and write it. So we went back, after the rehearsal, we went back to his apartment.
Doug and Barton had not been able to write the song for 1 hour.
Doug came up with the my, because he was thinking of My Generation by The Who, and Roger Daltrey stutters in that. Why don't you all fade away, and that was how he was channeling that. But the other thing I remember about it is Sharona was, well, you're going to be meeting Sharona. She was a real girl. She was a really cute, young, she was great, from Fairfax. And we had this cadre of fans, and they called themselves the Knackettes. You know, they were dressed like us, and they were friends of the band, and they would hang out with us. And there was one that Doug really had his eye on, that he really had lost his heart to, and it was this girl, Sharona.
当時のシャローナはファンの一人。しかし、ダグは彼女に恋をしてしまった。
The apartment we were playing and writing the song in, Doug was sharing with his girlfriend, Judy. And he starts singing out, My Sharona. And I remember going, Doug, you know, Judy's in the next room. But Doug was a lead singer, so he said, I don't care. We're writing a song. You know, so.
Woo!
the first time, just wow. Just wow. I mean, I, you know, it was a few years ago, but I still remember just saying like, just like, wow, I just couldn't believe it. It was funny because once I heard, when I was younger, Stevie Nicks sing Rihanna. And I always thought, how cool would it be to have a song written about you? And I think that was the name of the song, but it was just something that made me, I once thought, so I think one of my thoughts was, oh my God, did I just also have a song written about me? But the first time I was just like, wow, it was a good song. You know, I was just blown away by the pop, 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 you know, the beat, kind of what I just heard musically.
Oh, I mean, that was pretty much doubling the guitar line. I because of the way I play, I attack the bass a little different than most people. I'll show you later on. I play with a thumb pick, so I kind of really hit hard. So my playing certainly animated the riff, but the riff itself is pretty simple. And I'm doubling the guitar line pretty much. And I think, again, the most original aspect with the drumming, I thought, was so unique and different than most of the songs out there. Structure-wise, and Bruce was, again, the way he tuned his drums, and his playing was brilliant. And I think that song, again, Burden's leads were exceptional. And I think Sharona, to me, is never, as a lead guitarist, as a solo, I mean, I read guitar player magazines and everything. You know, it bothers me that Burden didn't get credit for writing definitely the best pop lead solo ever. I mean, that's an amazing solo, and having played with people that can't play it.
We had the song, and Doug had the idea. He said, we should have like an extended part for you to take a solo. And he came up with the chords. The C, G, G, F, 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 G came up with that, which was really serendipitous. It was major keys, and that was like playing to my strength. And that was it. And to this day, I have some people will tell me that, you know, people say it's like my favorite solo in a song or something like that. And I point out that, you know, it is a good solo. It's a very good solo. But there aren't that many songs that were that big a hit that have an extended solo.
My Sharona が完成し、メンバーはまずライブで披露。するとオーディエンスの反応は明らかで、レコーディング前からヒットの手応えを感じていた。います。1979年4月、ザ・ナックのファーストアルバムのレコーディングが行われた。レコーディングは約束通りスタジオでライブに近いスタイルで行われた。
So he said, David, tomorrow when we record the Knack, we're going to start with My Sharona. And I want the biggest drum sound ever. Okay? See you tomorrow. And it was like, oh my God, how am I going to do it? What am I going to do? Anyway, I was kind of nervous because I knew how big this potentially was going to be. So that night, I got some sleep, but not a lot of sleep. But I had this dream because it was just playing on my mind so much. And the dream was I could see myself setting up the microphones, on the drums particularly, what microphones I used, where I put the microphones, and then I went into the control room and I could see the console and I could see the EQ and I could see what I was doing with the EQ. I could hear it in my dream.
シンプルさを引き出すプロデューサーマイク・チャップマンの狙いはスタジオや機材選びに現れている。
Room was really big. It was like 60 foot wide, maybe 70 foot long. It was a big room. And we had the drums towards the back of the room. So I had these two microphones, these U67s, Neumanns, about 30 feet away from the kit, facing the kit. But that was kind of the big ambient sound. What Pete did, he had this one mic, this KM84, placed about 10 foot above the kit, right above the snare drum. And that was key to a lot of this sound. But when you hear that boom, boom, ba, boom, boom, ba, well, that was all the compressors moving in and out of time to really create this kind of pumping sound. So as the drummer started to go through the tones, like Pete's going, he looks at the EQ and said, wow, that sounds pretty damn good already. And he did a couple of things, you know, just to tune it in. But that's basically where the sound came from.
メンバーはいつものライブのような感覚でレコーディングにリラックスして臨んだ。
A lot of the songs would take about 4 hours to get the actual bed track, the drums, bass, and the main guitars. Then we would, Burton would add like doubles on the guitars or solos, and then we'd go into vocals. And Doug was very quick with his vocals. Again, this is Mike's technique with getting vocals and performances and pumping the artist up and getting the expression. Was fantastic, and it just worked really quickly. So it took 7 days to record, and we mixed the whole thing in 4 days. It was like an 11-day album. The fastest record I've ever made, other than a live record. so they really had a liveness to it.
Well, let's do this, this, and this. And we just knock them out. Mike was going, this is great. Let's have some wine, you know, celebrate at the end of the day. In other words, he was very, you know, I can't explain a producer's vibes or confidence in a band. If he's working very hard because the material isn't right, it's an effort to organize it, to make it right. Mike was just going with the flow, and when it sounded great, why fix it?
ファーストアルバムは満足のうちに完成した。
I think they had the record, they released the record within like 3 weeks of us finishing it. It came out really quick. And I remember one day I was driving down Hollywood Boulevard, and right across Hollywood Boulevard there's this big banner from one side to the other saying, get the Knack. And it's like, oh my god, this is going to be huge.
しかし、レコード会社がファーストシングルとして選んだのは、マイ・シャローナではなく、この曲だった。
Which was kind of interesting because when Capitol was releasing the record, they were saying, okay, the first single is going to be, and they mentioned one of the other songs. And we were trying really hard not to tell them their business. That didn't last long. But at the time, we were all trying very hard. And we went, oh, really? Oh, we thought Sharon. And they go, no, Sharon is the song. But it's hard, they're not playing hard rock on AM radio these days. We said, what the fuck? is that all about? Are you kidding?
アルバムが売れるとマイ・シャローナへのリクエストは一気に増え、セカンドシングルとしてリリースされた。そしてシングル版のジャケットを飾ったのはあのシャローナだった。
I wasn't breaking up with my boyfriend, and it was one of the times that it was just too hard for him to know me. Sometimes he'd be okay, or he'd have a girlfriend, and sometimes it would be too hard for him. So it was one of the times, but they asked me to be on the cover of the single, so he was there. And if you ever saw the cover of the single, I have my arm around Doug's face, like his head.And he placed the album cover of the album. So I'm holding the Knack album. My arm is around Doug. That's all Doug. I had nothing to do with anything. That's what I used to wear every day. 501 Levi's and usually a pink or white wife beater.
We were touring and Sharona became number one. We played Japan and we played in Hawaii, I guess,Sharona had broken up with her boyfriend prior to that. And then Sharona came to Hawaii and they started their relationship, sort of. Nice way to start a relationship, isn't it?
シャローナに恋をし、自分の気持ちを曲にしたダグ。ダグの気持ちはシャローナに届き、二人は付き合い始めた。しかし。
We were both young. I was really young and he was young. AndThe success happened quickly, and there's a major roller coaster to all of that, you know, and sex, drugs, and rock and roll is the real deal. It's all about, it's true. And, and basically we had a great, great time until it wasn't great for me anymore. My line was, it's time for me to be my Sharona.
二人に訪れた別れ。ダグにとってのマイ・シャローナではなくなってからも、時代を超え、この曲は世界中に響き渡った。アルバムを出すが、一枚目ほどの成功に恵まれなかったザ・ナック。1982年に一時解散。
So you're ready?
What's it like?
1994年、アメリカのいわゆるジェネレーション X 世代の青春を描きヒットした映画「リアリティバイクス」。
Under any orders to make the world a better place.
And you wonder why we never got involved.
Evian is naive spelled backwards.
Can you turn this up, please? Please? You won't be sorry. Thank you.
この映画の中で使われたマイ・シャローナが若者の間でブームとなり、なんと再びチャート入り。再結成していたザ・ナックの人気も再燃。1998年にリリースしたこのアルバムも話題になった。2010年、ボーカルのダグ・ファイガーが 脳腫瘍と肺がんのため死去。ザ・ナックの活動は止まった。
Then, at the end, I was definitely there for him. But, you know, there for me, you know, not only him. I mean, I was such a big part of my life, and it was really hard to see him go. He was true to himself all the way. He was a character, and he was strong and smart, super smart, and obviously persistent. And, you know, talented and fortunate, you know, before, you know, the only time he considered himself kind of carefree, not without care, just not fear, full of fear as we all get as adults. And it's just so interesting. It's like when we really shed the fear, we can really, you know, make number one hits.
I don't have the ambition gene. Doug had enough for five people, so that worked out fine. And I'm not a really driven person. I do things creatively still, and I put my work into it and my love into it, and I hope for big things and all that. But I'm not one of those people who would feel empty and nothing if I didn't have that. And so I think having that biggest song right out of the box just kind of took the pressure off. You know, I've done something, right?
I've played it with different people, really good musicians in clubs in LA and other places. They want to jam on it. And it's a privilege to do it. And sometimes it comes off great, you know, and it influenced them to maybe want to start playing music too. So like the Beatles or the Who influenced me, we've influenced a generation of musicians, which is always a privilege. And, you know, I'm really grateful, you know, to be thought of in that way, you know?
There's something special about producing music. And if you do it really well, it should transcend time. Some producers use a lot of sounds that are very fashion-oriented, like, oh, this is the hip sound that's going around right now. But in fact, what happens is within a couple of years, it'll sound dated. And that's where, with the Knack, because it didn't have any of those tricks, it was just so real, you still hear it today, and it's just very fresh.
息をつかせぬほど、パワフルでビート感あふれるタイトなサウンド。ザ・ナック、マイ・シャローナ。